ऑल द कंट्रीज ऑल द नेशंस एंड ऑल द इकोनॉमिक पर्सपेक्टिव्स एट द मेजर लेवल. नाउ गोइंग फर्दर विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द कंसेप्ट ऑफ सिग्निफिकेंस इन डिसीजन मेकिंग. Now the concept of economics, that is specifically speaking, the managerial economics applies with the concept of significance in the decision making with respect to the production decision, inventory decision, cost decision, marketing decision, investment decision, and personnel decision. So all the departments that are available in a particular organization, the managerial economics is focused. It is getting associated with all the factors of production, all the departments, and it is applicable in decision making, wherein it is helping all the factors that have been associated. Role of managerial economics, it focuses on the internal factors as well as the external factors, as we have seen in the fundamental concepts whenever we were dealing with. So specific functional oriented, the managerial economics is specifically focusing on various concepts with respect to the sales, marketing, firm, competition, pricing, capital, trade and public relations, intra and internations, environment and marketing, and other aspects. So not a single component has been left off wherein the economic is not a particular concern. Why? Because it is always associated with a certain concept called as an value. So whenever there is a value associated with a particular product, always the laws, the terms, the theories, or the applicability of economics is into existence, and we can say that the economic is applied and economic theories can be implemented. Managerial economics and decision making, the decision making perspectives can be applied with respect to the economic concept of the consumer behavior, the theory of the firm, and the theory of market structure. So whenever the nature of the behavior of the consumer changes, accordingly your managerial economic theory changes. A particular customer may demand certain amount of quantity, and tomorrow the particular customer may demand either less or either more of that particular quantity. With respect to the trading or with respect to the retailer or the supplier, he may have a certain amount of quantity available as on today, and he may not have that particular amount of quantity for selling as on tomorrow. So accordingly, what we can see, as the consumer behavior changes, accordingly the theory of the firm also states you that the nature of the firm also changes as and when there is an increase or decrease in the production, or increase and decrease in the demand perspectives. Theory of the market structure. Theory of market structure specifically focuses on different types of market that are into existence. The market that is a perfect competitive market, a monopolistic market, oligopoly market, duopoly market, and so on. So different markets have different market structures, and based on the market structure, the amount of quantity that is demanded, the competition position, the availability of number of firms, the availability of number of products, the pricing policy, everything changes as and when the market structure changes. Now, managerial economics and correlation with the management decision. So management decision with respect to the product. Specifically, you have to take the decision with respect to the product about what has to be manufactured, how it has to be manufactured, and so on. So all the five WH questions we have already studied, that is what to produce, how to produce, how much to produce, and so on. Pricing, what should be the pricing, which can be affordable to all the consumers at the lower level and at the larger scale. So a particular product, that is a toothpaste or a particular biscuits. Now, whenever we say a particular consumption product or a particular costliest or a precious product, depending on the availability of quantity, depending on the availability or the affordability for that particular consumer, the value of the product changes. We cannot say that a gold is available for rupees 5 and a biscuit is available for rupees 50,000. Why? Because every product is having a different valuation, and accordingly, the price of that particular product has been set. The quantity availability, biscuits can be available in abundant nature, whereas the gold cannot be available in abundant nature. And hence, based on the availability factor, the pricing of this particular product changes. Comparison with the another product, that is gold and diamond. So accordingly, the amount of diamond that is available is very less, and accordingly, its pricing is much higher. So the pricing of that particular product also differs with respect to the availability. So as and when the supply increases, your value or the quantity of the price that has been demanded also increases, and the value of the product also decreases. Next thing, make or buy decision. So management also has to consider the perspectives of make or buy decision about what has to be manufactured and what has not to be manufactured. So it has to be very wise decision about whenever you go for a manufacturing concern, that whether a particular company must manufacture or whether company must not manufacture, whether the customers will buy your product or whether the customer will not buy your product, whether it will be affordable, whether it will not be affordable, what quantity will be bought, what quantity will not be bought. So all these particular concepts with respect to the production, make or buy, output, pricing, productivity, inventory, are completely related with your management decision, and we have to see about whether it will be beneficial for the organization and it will generate positive profit or negative profit. decision science, always managerial economics deals with the concept of decision science because it is always associated, it is always concerned with the numerical analysis, statistical estimation, forecasting, and game theory, wherein the nature, the behavior, condition, or the individual psychology always changes. Tomorrow, today I may purchase certain quantity. Tomorrow, I may purchase higher quantity or a lower quantity. So, based on this particular concern, that is the quantitative perspective, that is, which is having a numerical concern. 1 kg, 2 kg, 5 kg, 10 kg, 100 kg, 1 ton, 10 ton, and so on. So, always it is associated with a certain value or a certain quantity. The pricing of the product, the price may be costing of that particular product may be 1 rupee, 5 rupee, 10 rupee, 1 lakh, 2 lakh, 10 crore, and so on. So, numerical analysis. Statistical estimation, a particular quantity is increased. That is, today the demand is 10%, tomorrow demand is 15%. Today the demand has fallen by 10%, tomorrow the demand may increase by 50%. So in this way, statistical estimations can be done. And it is completely related with the concept of forecasting. That is, we have to forecast about what can happen in near future. Now, the understanding the concept of economic problem. Economic problem specifically focuses on three principles. What are those principles? That is unlimited ones. So why? Because economics dealing with the concept of human psychology, human tendency, always there are the wants, needs, and demands of a particular human being or a particular individual are completely unlimited. Today, if you have something, then tomorrow, what do you think? Again, you want some another thing. Today, if you have got holiday, again, we see that. Again, we want holiday tomorrow. Today, if we are consuming certain product, what we are thinking that tomorrow I want additional certain products. So, unlimited wants. The wants of a particular individual always keeps on increasing when it is not stable at any stage or point of time. Limited or scarce means. So, for satisfaction of these particular limited wants, always the limited or scarce means are available. Now, what are those scarce means? The scarcity of means with respect to the factors of production available at the natural concern. So nature being very stable, accordingly, the resources that are also available are also very scarce, and we have to see that all the resources are utilized in very optimum manner. And lastly, alternative uses. So alternative uses, we have to see about how the factors of production are being implemented, how they are being applied, and how it can be considered over a period of time. Economic problem, with respect to the economic problem, that is what to produce, how to produce, how much to produce, and for whom to produce. And macroeconomic problem with respect to how to achieve full utilization, how to attain the efficiency, and how to accelerate or how to develop the growth perspectives. Now, the definition of firm, we have also studied, or a short introduction was given with respect to the definition. With respect to firm is an organization that produces and sells goods and services with the goal of maximizing its profit. So maximization, that is, we have seen understanding the concept with respect to the benefits or the objective of the firm. It may be either profit maximization or wealth maximization. At the initial stage, the companies in the earlier stage of that is before 2000 era, they were focusing on the profit maximization. But today, the companies or the business organization, they are specifically focusing on wealth maximization, where they have to see that how the wealth of the country, how the wealth of the company, how the wealth of that particular organization is being developed over a period of time. And what is the major output, a major source for this particular development? That is production and selling of the goods and services. First thing, you have to see that the goods and services that have been required are being produced and they have been reaching at that particular market level. And whenever they are reaching to that particular market level, they are also being purchased by the consumer. So if a particular product is being reached at a particular market and if the consumer is not purchasing that particular product, then accordingly we can say that the consumption pattern fails. Understanding the objectives of the firm, profit maximization, sales maximization, value or the wealth maximization, managerial utility maximization, satisfactory level of profit, and lastly, the other objectives. Then we have also seen with respect to the concept of total revenue, total cost, marginal revenue, and marginal cost. So what is the benefit or what is the drawback wherein if marginal cost increases or decreases, if there is a difference between increase in marginal cost over the marginal revenue, decrease in the marginal cost over the marginal revenue, and what is the concept wherein if marginal cost is equal to marginal revenue. So impact on the company, impact on the profit, impact on the revenue generation, impact on the commodity, impact on the market, and impact on the world economy at the major level. Profit maximization. Now, always whenever we see that profit maximization is a particular concept of a particular firm, then accordingly, a particular company is always looking for a certain concern that over a period of time, that is whenever the break-even point has been achieved, only after that particular concern, the concept of wealth maximization can be obtained. If the break-even point is not achieved by a particular company, then accordingly, the company remains at a certain position or industry remains at a certain position of only profit maximization. And up to that level only, the profit can be achieved. Over a period of time, whenever the particular break-even point has been achieved, the sales that has been conducted, that is after the break-even point, leads to the wealth maximization or the sales maximization for a particular firm. Now, there is another concept that is called as sales maximization. The sales maximization perspective is specifically given by Baumol, and it is called as Baumol's static and dynamic model. It specifically focuses on the concept of total cost, total profit, total revenue, and maximum amount of profit. So what Baumol specifically focuses that a company must have all the factors of production, all the cost, all the revenue perspectives in a very static nature. It must not be changed, whatever may be the terms and conditions, whatever may be the changes in the economy. So your total cost, your total profit and total revenue must be stable, must be static, and only then the minimum or the maximum amount of profit can be generated. So whenever a particular profit is being generated, for that particular question, do we have to see? We have to see that all the factors. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So whenever we say that is a Baumol static model is into existence, the total cost, total profit and total revenue are very stable and it does not changes over a period of time. So accordingly, based on those identification, we have to see that all the costs are always stable, and whenever those particular costs are stable, only then the minimum or the maximum amount of profit can be generated or it can be created. Second valuation model with respect to wealth maximization is we have the Maris growth maximization model. Maris growth maximization model specifically focuses on the utility function. Now, what is the utility? That is, over a period of time, what benefit can be generated, what benefit can be derived from the factors of production that have been employed, and who are the major benefiters or the beneficiaries of this particular concern. The major beneficiaries are the first thing, that is the internal management, that is the control by the managers and the control by the shareholders or the owners of that particular firm. So here the function specifically focuses with respect to the UM. Now UM stands for control by the managers, and UO stands by the control by the shareholders or control of the owners. Now here, the UM, that is the control by the managers, is the function of. So what are the various functions that have been associated? The various functions that have been associated by the value or the wealth maximization of the managers are salary, power, status, and job security. So if all the particular concerns are of a stable state or of a stable nature, that is a particular person is earning a good amount of salary, he's happy and satisfied with that particular salary, he's having the particular power that has been associated, that is the authority, responsibility, duties, power that have been generated, the status that has been provided for that particular individual, and the job security that has also been given. So if all these particular factors are quite stable, then we can say that the control by the managers is quite effective. The control by the shareholders or the owners has been very effective, or is of a growth maximization, or is utility has been occupied. Whenever we say that all the factors with respect to the profit, market share, output, capital, and public esteem ratios are been satisfied or are they been fulfilled. So in this case, the Maris growth maximization model specifically focuses on control by managers and control by shareholders. Third theory, we have the Williamson's managerial discretionary theory. The Williamson managerial discretionary theory specifically focuses on the function of SM and I. So utility of manager function, that is U, that is UM. Now utility of manager, the manager is specifically termed denominated with respect or with the denomination of UM. So utility of M, that is a UOM, is the function of SM and I. So what is that particular concern? S stands for the staff expenditure, M stands for the manager involvements, and ID stands for the discretionary investment. So in this case, we have to see, we have to identify, that is Williamson specifically focuses on the managerial function theory. And managerial function theory specifically deals with the discretionary theory or the discretionary power that has been done or discretionary expenditure that has been done with respect to the staff, the development of the skill, tendency and habits of an individual, and accordingly, the discretionary investment that has been done by an organization for development of the people or the nature of the organization. the role or the scope of profit in the market system. Now I'll just read out to you. You can read the theoretical perspective with respect to the measurement of performance, premium to cover or sustain, ensure future supply of the future capital, motivating the entrepreneurs, providing the resources, self-adjustment and sources of revenue. So in this case, the scope of profit, how the profit can be expanded or how the profit can be increased. So for increasing the profit, first thing what we have to see, we have to see that the performance of an individual employee is been measured, whether a particular company, whether a particular individual employee is performing or whether he is not performing. If he is performing, how he is performing, and whether he is underperforming, whether he is overperforming. If he is overperforming or underperforming, then accordingly whether his pay scale or his pay is been related to that particular concept or that particular thing or not. If a particular employee is underperforming, he's not doing his duties, job and responsibilities, then accordingly the amount of payment that is to be given to him, whether it has to be increased or whether it has to be decreased. So measurement of performance. Premium to cover or sustain, that is if at any stage, if the particular product or if the manufacturing activity has been increased or it has been decreased, then we have to see about how a particular product can be identified, how a particular product can be attained. So in order to cover the losses, in order to cover the goods, services and commodity, we have to see about how the benefit can be arrived. Motivating the entrepreneurs, we have to also see that the entrepreneurs that have been associated with the business concern, they are always been motivated and they are concerned about the benefit that can be derived over a period of time. And lastly, we have the concept of Adam Smith and the invisible hand. So invisible hand, wherein we have to see the focus of the Adam Smith is also of a particular concern, wherein the invisible hand has been derived as the concept of government. So at any stage, any point of time, whenever we say that a particular product is or a particular commodity is purchased or it is being sold, always there is government into perspective. Now, which is that particular government? The government can be all called as a state government or the central government or the local government, that is the district or the taluka government that is into existence. So always there is a government which is regulating, which is controlling all the factors, and something driving force which is controlling the business is called as the government it is into existence. In terms of demand, in terms of supply, in terms of producer, seller, manufacturer, consumption, market, production, distribution, consumption, at every stage, every point of time, there is a particular concern or there is a certain invisible hand, and that particular invisible hand is controlling the business activity that have been generated, regulated over a period of time. So that particular concept wherein a particular activity has been regulated, controlled by the various factors of production is called the invisible hand, as been provided by the Adam Smith. So in this case, example of you may be reading with the examples at this particular stage, and accordingly you can understand about how government controls or regulates the business activities. Okay, that's all for today's lecture. I'm posting the link of attendance in the chat box. Student, to please mark your attendance. Someone let me know the confirmation whenever you complete marking the attendance.